Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out to Distinction Monday this evening. I know that you could have been anywhere else this evening and you chose to come here this night. So I want to acknowledge you all for being here this evening and taking time out of your night and being a contribution to not only the community, but to me and to yourselves. So thank you for being here this evening. On that note, my name is Chris Austin. I am the training manager here at Gratitude Training, and I'm also a trainer here for the third level and for some other workshops. I am 38 years old, and I have been involved in this work for about 8 years. I did my trainings about 8 years ago, and I haven't stopped. I haven't looked back. I volunteered. I was continuously in service, and then about 5 years ago, I was asked to come on board as an employee, and I have worked my way up from a training coordinator to a training manager to now trainer. And so it's been an amazing ride, an amazing journey. There's no place else I'd rather be. I love this work and I love everything about it. A little bit about my background before I got into all this transformational work is that I've kind of been a jack of all trades. So I used to be a radio DJ, was a radio disc jockey for a while. I was in education for 14 years. I did after-school programs, I was a teacher, I ran summer camps, all of that stuff for 14 years. And I was also huge into sports and athletics. And my whole life I have worked with teams of people and really being a contribution to people, especially when I would work with kids. And there came a moment when I realized that it was tough being in education, seeing the kids, seeing the parents, seeing the families. And going into this work had me realize that there's such a different way to approach education and to approach people and to make a difference. And during my Masterful Living journey, I decided to leave that area of teaching. And I decided to take a risk and start a whole new career out. And I still experience myself teaching people just on a transformational level now. And I'm super excited, and I was just hired as a trainer, and I had my first training this year in November. So I'm very excited for that. So on that note, enough about me. So now I want to say, who here is ready to take your life to the next level? Yes. And who here is ready to live an extraordinary life? All right, then you have come to the right place this evening. So Distinction Mondays. So, you might be saying, what are we going to do this evening? Well, I'm going to first start off by talking about broken agreements. Okay? In transformation, we speak into broken agreements a lot in part one, part two, and masterful living. Okay? I'm going to spend some time talking about this. We're going to have a discussion, a conversation. We're going to ask some questions. And then we'll do a little exercise that has you guys practice broken agreements. And then when I'm complete with that, we're going to take probably about a 10-15 minute break. And then my counterpart over here, Jay, is going to come up and he's going to do an exercise with you that this exercise is actually going to support you in leading into his exercise. So don't fall asleep because it's going to support you in the next exercise, okay? So before we got started, we talked, we got to know you, so glad you guys are here. We introduced ourselves already, so I'm not going to take time to do that here. So, you ready to begin?
Yeah.
All right, cool. So let's start off by saying, what is a broken agreement? Like, who can remember from part one, part two, what is a broken agreement? What do you guys think it is?
Breaking your word.
Okay, so breaking your word and a promise that you didn't keep. Exactly. It's both of those things, right? So having a broken agreement is giving your word and not following through and not doing it, okay? So you had a broken agreement, okay? Now, when that happens, have you ever stopped to say to yourself, what are the prices that other people are paying when we break agreements or when I break an agreement? So I'll say that again. What are the prices that other people pay when we break our agreements? So What do you think, like somebody in your life, what's the price they pay?
They lose trust.
Okay, they lose trust.
For you.
Okay, so they don't trust you. Now, would you say that that's a price that they pay? So let's take this, I'm gonna bring this down a little bit, okay? So say that you're late, you're gonna meet somebody at the movies, mm-hmm. right? You're gonna meet somebody at the movies. And you don't show up. You know, you don't show up, you're like, totally forgot, you got busy in your day. You show up, you broke your agreement to attend that movie with somebody. What do you think, the price they pay? So when I say price they pay, what do you think I mean by like the price they pay? You know what I mean.
Well, they lost valuable time, but also the trust, you know, they don't, in my opinion, they would lose trust for you,
mm-hmm.
And might lose trust for other people. Like
okay.
They feel that,
yeah.
you know, the work, that trust.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Hard to trust.
So
I'm gonna
have you take a look at something a little differently, okay? So the price, so yes, they might not trust you. And that goes into the next thing we're going to talk about is maybe some of the prices that you pay, okay? So we'll come back to that for a second. So if we're talking about what are the prices they pay when you don't show up at the movie, could be, man, I thought we had a friendship. They don't really like me, right? Could be something like that. They could say, they don't like me. You know, like they don't like me, or you know, man, I can't count on them. I can't trust them. You know, like you said. So, what do you think that they say about themselves when that happens? Because this is the next level, right? So we do this out in the drift. Like we say, oh, you know, I'm really sorry. You know, I can't, really tired. I can't make that tonight, or my kid is sick. You know, I can't make that. And we just carry on about our day, and we never really stop to think about the impact we're having on another human being's life. Like, really. You know, like, we never really stop to say, hey, you know what, I'm not going to make it out to dinner, like, I'll catch you later. You know? And what we're creating in another human being when we do that. You know? And that's what we say in transformation, that we get to start looking at the prices other people are paying, that when we choose to break our word, even when we're late to like getting our hair done. You know, think about that domino effect for that hairdresser and the price that they're paying and the conversations they make about themselves. You know, I'm not worthy. I'm not good enough. I'm not honored. All those kinds of conversations that they tell themselves. Now, could it be conscious or unconscious? We don't know. You know, it's probably a mix of both of them. So breaking a broken agreement is a real thing to look at in transformation. Because out in the drift, we just keep going. Oh, sorry, I was late. And people will just be okay with that. Oh, no problem. Right? We'll go, oh, no problem. Jerk. You know, and then we'll be like, jerk, or we'll turn to our friend and be like, oh my God, can you believe that Jay was late again? Like, he's so rude. You can't count on him. And then that's what we do in the drift, okay? But that's not what we do here in gratitude training and transformation. We learn all about broken agreements so that we don't carry all those grungies. Remember that from part one? We don't carry all those grungies or those gross, yucky stuff with us, okay? So those are some prices other people pay. What are the prices that you pay? So this is the one, right, that when you break your word. So, like, what's something that you broke your word on?
I said I would go to the gym yesterday.
Okay. You didn't go?
I did not go.
Okay.
I stayed in my bed and I watched Once Upon a Time.
Awesome. Okay.
Once.
So what would you say if you were to look at that right now? Like, what's the price that you're paying for breaking your word of going to the gym?
I felt guilty, and I'm not going to get my end result if I'm not committed to doing what I said I would do. I'm not going to get the result that I want.
Okay, so I'm going to write that up here. So one of the prices that you paid, are paying, are right now?
Yeah.
Even? Okay. Is you feel guilt? Anything else?
Well, then I ate cookies, so I felt extra guilty. And like I let myself down.
Okay, so if you were like peel the onion under that, so what did you say about yourself when you're like, man, I let myself down? Like, what are you really saying about yourself?
That I wasn't, I wanted to be lazy and comfortable instead of.
So like I'm lazy? Gym.
Yeah.
Like you're like, I'm lazy?
Yeah.
Alright. So like, I'm lazy. Okay. And then what would you say by having these conversations, right, and these thoughts of I'm guilty, I'm lazy, what would you say are some prices that you pay in life from having those conversations? Like, what are the prices?
I don't create the results that I want.
Like what?
Like losing 5 pounds within the month or fitting into a bathing suit, like being out of breath from walking upstairs, like not being fit.
So then what are some tangible things in your life? So when you can't wear that bathing suit, when you're walking upstairs, like what are some results you have in your life, like from not going to the gym and feeling this?
Like feeling unhappy.
Okay, so if you're not happy,
right,
what would you be being?
Sad.
Yeah, so you're sad.
Yes.
So one of the prices, one of the prices that you would say is that you experience sadness and depression.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So now do you see how breaking your agreement to go to the gym, if you bring it down, peel the onion, right? Just as, oh, I didn't go to the gym, huh? You know, you could either be like, oh, I didn't go to the gym and just make a joke about it, you know, watch TV or whatever. But if you sat there and said, man, I didn't go to the gym, why didn't I do that? You know, and we'll talk about that in a little bit of the process of mounting the broken agreement, you know, with yourself and coming from a new place. But like, think about that. You know, by breaking a broken agreement, the result that gets created in you, it's kind of ill, you know, just by the simple little things in life. Does that make sense? Any questions?
Yeah, but I have a little bit more complex question.
Okay, yeah, go ahead.
That's a waste of time, but
no, never wasting my time.
With these issues that are going on in my life, I recognize that I was a doormat with my boyfriend.
Okay.
So I said, that's it. The agreement to myself is I'm not letting anyone disrespect me or treat me like a doormat anymore.
Okay,
okay? My time is valuable.
Mm-hmm.
So my girlfriend was late yesterday. I sat in her driveway for a half hour. She said, come on in. I said, no, because it's going to be longer. I'm sitting in my driveway, not tolerating it. So then she got mad at me. And, oh, she gets in the car. And then later on in the night, I wanted to go. It was 10 o'clock. I told myself I'm going to be leaving, going to bed at a better hour. And here she was. She wanted me to stay. She wanted me to stay. It ended up being 2 more hours later. I mad at myself because I didn't leave. I broke the agreement with myself. And then I finally go home, and I'm upset. And she decided to take an Uber home anyways because she wanted to stay longer. Okay.
Okay.
So now we're not talking.
Okay. This was yesterday.
Yeah. And I feel like, help me out with that, because I
sure.
feel like I stood up for myself, but maybe too late.
Okay, so let's start here. Let me ask you this. When do you think in that explanation, when do you think that you broke your word to yourself? Like, what was the exact moment in that story where you would say you broke your word?
The initial one was tolerating it, sitting in a driveway for half hour.
Okay, so you would say, so I just want to make sure I'm hearing you right. So you broke your agreement with yourself when you decided, when you made a choice of sitting in the car waiting for her. Was it 5 minutes when you were like, this is ridiculous, or was it right off the bat where you were like?
It was 5 minutes.
Okay.
Like everybody's, you know.
Yeah, I mean, you're not.
Before I was pulling in and give her a second to grab her keys or lock up. Okay.
Sure,
yeah.
Okay. So then you would say maybe after that half hour.
Yeah.
You had an experience of you breaking your agreement to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, she goes. She's disrespected my feelings.
Okay.
And I'm taking it.
Okay, so here's what we do in transformation, ready? Here's the thing we look at, is that we say that we are, this is, well, we speak into this in Masterful Living a lot, we say that we are 100% responsible, and your friend, get ready, is 0% responsible. Okay, I'm going to say it again. So we're 100% responsible, and your friend is 0% responsible. What do you hear me saying that? Like, what do you think I mean by that?
It's my fault.
Okay.
Yeah, but then initially, I was afraid that I'm going to be lonely. I'm going to lose my friend.
Mm-hmm.
If I took off and said, oh, I've told you once, I've told you twice, I'm not doing it anymore. You know, I waited 5 minutes, I'm out of here.
Okay.
Then I lose a friend.
Okay. So when I say there's 100% responsibility, we say in Masterful Living, you know, in gratitude context, that I'm responsible for everything 100% of the time. So even, yeah, accountability, right, to account for is what accountability means, okay? So we come at it as a place of responsibility and ownership, right? Because right away I heard you say, it's my fault. And I felt that that was real for you. Like, that's the experience that you were experiencing right now, in this moment, that it's my fault. And now she's not my friend or whatever, the spiral may happen from that, okay? So I'm going to give you a tool tonight with Broken Agreement that's going to have you be free of all the shame, all the guilt, or whatever it is you experience with your friend. I'm going to give you a tool that the next time you're sitting in your car, you can use, and within 5 minutes, you can feel clean, good, and free, and have the friendship with your friend that you always wanted to have and that you're committed to having. What do you think about that?
I like that.
Okay. Because this is what happens, and this is so good, and I appreciate your vulnerability and sharing this with me, because, you know, these are the things that cause sadness in our world, which then creates sadness in families, which then goes out into the world.
It shows up over and over again, just kind of different scenarios this week. You know what I mean? Like, it keeps showing up.
Okay.
The same habits.
Yeah. So we'll get into that. We'll get into how can I handle my broken agreements to come from a clean space in a new context to create a whole new outcome. So you could leave here tonight having tools to create a whole new outcome with your friend.
Okay.
By ownership and responsibility, and to get committed to that relationship tonight or tomorrow. Okay?
Yes.
All right. Love it. Cool. All right. So if we look at it on a next level, so now we talked about what are some prices I pay, what are some prices other people pay. What do you guys think, like, why do we break agreements in the first place? Like, there's a process to do this in transformation. So then, have you ever stopped to really say to yourself, why didn't I break that agreement? Or why do I, like, break my word?
Safe.
Okay, to be safe. What else? Why do you break your word?
To be comfortable.
Okay. You guys remember? Yeah, so we break our agreements, right? What you guys are talking about are the survival strategies. Those from
yes.
Part one. So you said being safe and comfortable, we put into one.
Well, being right, that I have like enough time to get where I'm going. Like, I know Lake Worth is 40 minutes from my house,
yep,
but I'm leaving 20 minutes before I should be there, because I know that I can beat my GPS.
Right.
And gotcha. Then I break more agreements because I'm breaking the speed limit or...
Right.
You
so
know.
You get committed to being right.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So being safe, being comfortable, being right, there's two more. Do you remember what they are? Sorry?
Look good.
Yep, looking good. You remember the other one?
Safe, comfortable, right, look good.
Being in control. So that's what we call the survival strategies. Remember, we did this a lot in part one.
Yeah.
A lot in part one, and took it to the next level in part two. And you will take it to a different level of Masterful Living when you step into that. And as you know, you are a graduate of Masterful Living, and you'll take it into your life. That's work, right? So Yeah, like we break our agreements because of the survival concepts of looking good, being right, being in control, staying safe, and being comfortable. Okay? Now, what are some of the reasons? So what are some reasons? So we just talked about why we break our agreement, you know, to look good, to be right, to be in control, to stay safe, to be comfortable. But what are some of the reasons or excuses, Mule? Like, you guys know you're good at them. What are the excuses that you make as to, like, why, like, you didn't go to the gym? Come on, you gotta have some good ones.
I was really tired.
Yeah, you're tired. Okay, so I'm gonna write that up here. So, excuses, right? We're gonna call this excuses for breaking agreement. Okay? So this marker is not very fabulous.
I didn't feel like it.
Tired. Don't feel like it. What else?
I wanted what I wanted what I wanted.
What do we call that?
Bratty.
Okay. Waiting for it. What are some things, Terry, that you come up with, like why you break your word?
I don't know if this is right. I'm sure it's not. But what comes in my head is the reason why I'm doing a lot of things that I'm doing is to make other people happy.
Okay, so pleasing others?
Pleasing
like
others.
People pleaser?
Or myself, like a doormat.
So, like, wanting to be liked? Or what is it for you? Pleasing others? Did that land when I said
yeah.
that for you? Okay. So, pleasing others. And so, let me ask you this. What are you afraid of if people don't like you?
Lonely.
You'll be lonely.
I'm lonely anyhow.
That was my next question. Okay. So, you experience being lonely. So your excuse is, I'm going to do it, I'm going to break my agreement to myself so that people like me, so that I'm not lonely. But then when you break your agreement to yourself, the result is still lonely.
Because I get mad at a certain point, and I blow up.
Okay, just something to look at, right? That even though you're still breaking your agreement to yourself, you're still having the same result. Selling out. So if we could categorize all of those reasons or excuses and title them, those are the survival context that we just spoke into. Do you guys see that? Those are the survival context. What do you think, Terry, that this pleasing others falls into?
To look good, to make them happy.
Yeah, right? So pleasing others is a huge part of the survival context of you're committed to looking good. So you'll sell out on all of your word, your integrity, just to please other people and have them like you. And in the end, it doesn't work because it still has you experience loneliness and sadness and depression or whatever it may be, those were years. So that's when you want to start to ask yourself, is it worth it? Is it worth it to start to break my agreements and to sell out, to look good, and pay the prices that I pay and other people pay? Is it worth it? It's a question to ask yourself, okay? So let's look at the prices, right? We spoke into the prices and where we go with that. And what are we really doing? Right? What are we doing? So what are we doing to other people and to ourselves when we consistently break agreements, use excuses like this to not be our word or say what we're going to do or have? What are we really doing? Like, what are we causing in ourselves and others? What do you guys think it is? I'm going to tell you what it is. We're causing pain. It hurts. It hurts to live like this. It doesn't feel good. Remember, like, when we just keep, remember that growth maintenance circle when we keep saying we're just maintaining and doing the same thing over and over and over again? Remember, like, your trainer probably, like, did this up on the easel? You're doing the same thing over and over again. And you're going to keep getting the same result over and over again. Because you're committed to breaking your agreements with yourself, making up excuses about it over and over again, and you're creating pain. You're causing pain while trying to avoid it. You're avoiding something, okay? And when we start to avoid and start to create these things, we start to make up self-limiting beliefs. Okay, do you guys remember that from part two? Self-limiting beliefs. So when we start to operate over broken agreement, after broken agreement, after broken agreement, you feel gross about yourself. You're like, oh my God, I just totally lied to that person. Oh well, we say oh well, but then we kind of walk down with our head down, not really knowing it. And you keep doing the same thing over and over again. And so we start to make self-limiting beliefs that we're not very nice to ourselves, or we're not very nice to each other either, right? So if you keep breaking your word to me over and over again, I'm going to be like, I can't count on Emily. I can't count on her to do this job. I'm not going to ask her to do that anymore. And then I just might give up on you. And that's going to cause pain for you. And that's also going to cause pain for me. So do you guys see how we walk around? So, like, do you see how you caused pain for yourself last night sitting in the car? Do you see how you may have caused pain for your friend last night sitting in the car? Okay. So
that's the blame about me again.
Right. And it, that's
if
the,
anything, well,
that's
can't
the
you
maintenance
just love
thing.
Me for who I am?
Right.
Actually, my boyfriend said that too. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we want to look at, we keep generating the same results, and it could even be a different person. Like, how crazy is that? Is like one of your best friends and your boyfriend are saying the same thing to you. So what we say here at Gratitude Training is that you get to look at that. Remember the word source? Remember, like, learning that word, that I'm the cause, the creator, I'm generating the things that are happening in my environment. So that's when you want to start to look at, like, what do I think about myself? That's what we're talking about here with self-limiting beliefs. Like, what kind of person am I? What am I saying that I keep creating my boyfriend, my ex-boyfriend, whatever it is, my friend, to sit here and say, why can't you just love me for myself? The real question there, Terry, is why can't I just love myself for who I am? Like, that's what you need to say, get to say to yourself. So if you're hearing that from two of the closest people in your life, why can't you just love me for who I am? I'm telling you, contextually, you get to say to you, why can't I just love me the way that I am? And, like, say that to yourself in the mirror. And then answer it for yourself. Because that's what we're talking about, these self-limiting beliefs. So what is something that you made up about yourself yesterday? You know, like, what did you say about yourself?
I'm a bad person.
I'm a bad person.
I push everybody away.
You push everybody away. What's something you made up about yourself not going to the gym?
I am lazy.
Okay. And what kind of person is lazy?
Somebody who self-sabotage.
Okay.
I self-sabotage.
So I sabotage everything.
Yeah.
Okay.
I suck.
Okay, you suck. So, like, a failure, kind of, or, like, what is that for you? Like, what is it when you put your head on the pillow at night, you say about yourself, I suck?
I'm an asshole.
Okay, you're an asshole.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're walking around, both of you are walking around with those self-limiting beliefs that aren't serving you, that you're going to continue to create the same results, you're going to continue to create those results in people around you as well, because they're going to see you as an asshole, because you see yourself as an asshole, you know? They're going to see you as not a good person because you believe you're not a good person. So there's nothing else that you can do than to keep creating that same result over and over again with people. And it's all by, like, having a broken agreement with yourself. All of it. That's what it stems from. From having broken agreements with yourself because you keep going down. oh, what, I had a broken agreement, oh my God, I'm this awful person, and then you start to make things up about yourself, and that all comes from you just not being your word. All of it. It's just from not being your word, okay? So with all of that, we might say to ourselves, how can we reclaim our sense of worthiness? How can we get rid of that and reclaim our worthiness? How can we reclaim our honor or our dignity? How do we get back into integrity to begin to clean up our mess so that we can reestablish or recreate trust? Okay, so I'm going to say that again. How do we get back into integrity and begin to clean up our mess so that we can reestablish or create trust? Ready for the answer? We handle our broken agreements. Okay, it's simple. We handle our broken agreements. And we have a process throughout the training that supports us in handling our broken agreements. They vary from part one to part two to Masterful Living. And I'm going to go over the process with you to what we use in Masterful Living. Okay? So you haven't done this yet, but it's the next level for you because you're a part two grad. So it's exactly the next level of where you should be. Actually, it's perfect that you're here tonight to learn this. And this will be a good refresher for you on how to reclaim your honor and your dignity and life. Sound fun?
Perfect.
Okay. Oh, so I actually have them written up here. Okay. So before I turn them, I'm going to say, remember, okay, this is one thing to remember about broken agreements, handling a broken agreement. All breakdowns and broken agreements are to be celebrated. Okay? You might not feel like it. Okay? You might not be like, yes, my friend is mad at me. Yes, I didn't go to the gym. But there's a life lesson in there that is honorable and available to you when you're willing to look at the breakdown and the broken agreement and do the work that's needed. Okay? So there's a lesson in there, and this is where growth takes place. For you to go, yes, that sucks. What's the lesson here that I'm here to learn right now so that I can grow and create something new? Okay? So, I know it's crazy, right, that we say celebrate the breakdown, like, okay, great. I totally just got at it with my friend. We're arguing. She thinks I'm the worst friend ever. Okay, awesome. Like, authentically to go.
That's what you're saying?
Yeah. Like, I'm saying that to authentically go, instead of being, like, what we do in the drift and just be like, oh my God, I'm never gonna have it and this and that and I'm this and that and keep going down that hole. I'm inviting you to look at it in a whole new way and go, okay, awesome. She's super angry at me right now. She doesn't want to be my friend. She's saying these things to me. That's awesome because there's a lesson here right now for me. Right? That's like the first step. Because this is the only place where you can grow and reclaim your dignity and reclaim your honor and regain your trust, is be willing to take a look at what is the lesson in it for me. You know, whether it's even just to yourself. Okay? So when we handle broken agreements, what we do is there is a 5-step process to handling broken agreements. Okay? So number one is you acknowledge a broken agreement. Who here remembers how to acknowledge a broken agreement? Anyone? I know you do. Yes.
I acknowledge my broken agreement.
Right, so yeah. So do the process for us.
The full.
So I acknowledge my broken agreement.
I acknowledge my broken agreement.
Okay.
I said it.
Yeah, we'll stop there. Okay. Thank you. So we'll stop there. So the first thing is to be responsible, to take ownership, and be accountable and say, I acknowledge my broken agreement. That alone in itself, we don't do in the drift. So to say to your friend, I acknowledge my broken agreement. Or in this case, it's to you, because you broke your word to yourself, both of you. So it's to you. I acknowledge my broken agreement for not going to the gym. I acknowledge my broken agreement for staying later than I was committed to staying. You could do this to yourself.
I was going to say, just to yourself.
Yeah,
I wouldn't
absolutely
want to call my girlfriend and tell her this because she'll think.
Yeah, that'd be weird. Yeah. And you can learn tools, but like, this is something you never need another human being sometimes to do this, Now, sometimes you might, like, because you might have to just go to your friend, and you might just be like, hey, I just want to let you know, I know I was late. Like, you don't necessarily have to use this lingo, this to have that conversation, but it's a tool here for you to say to your friend, you know, hey, I just want to, like, let you know I was late, and I'm sorry about that, you know, like, in normal terminology.
Right.
But in gratitude context, this is the first step. I acknowledge my broken agreement. I acknowledge my broken agreement for not going to the gym. I acknowledge my broken agreement for whatever the situation may be. Okay? Step number one. Step number two, distinguish facts from your interpretation. Okay? So in part one, if you recall, the trainer did fact interpretation. Okay? That's when we talk about the facts are the facts. And then we start to interpret things sometimes, and we start to make up a story, and we put all this stuff to it, okay? So facts are what happened, right? What happened, what are the facts? That's what we're saying here when we say distinguish facts, okay? Meaning, my friend was late, I sat in my car, I chose to sit there. You know, like the facts. I didn't go to the gym. You know, facts, the reason why you didn't go to the gym. Like, clean-cut facts, no energy on that. You must distinguish them from your interpretation. Because you start to create these interpretations by being like, oh my God, I sat in this car for 30 minutes, my friend is so inconsiderate.
Right.
That's an interpretation. That's not really what happened. Your friend wasn't being inconsiderate, she was being her, she was doing her. Just like you're sitting in the car doing you, you know, sitting there breaking your agreement to yourself. So you gotta distinguish the facts from your interpretation. So start to notice the meaning and the story you're putting into it. Like how Emily is like, yeah, I'm lazy, you know, I'm lazy, I don't wanna go to the gym. And then I got 8 cookies because I justified that I could sit there and eat cookies. Oh, and then I felt kind of guilty about eating those cookies and oh my God, I suck. Those are all interpretations. That's not real. Emily doesn't suck. You know, she's not lazy. Those are belief systems that come off of her story or her interpretation of the event that happened. So number two is distinguish your facts from your interpretation. Number three is determine your accountability in the matter. Okay? So determine who you were being that generated that broken agreement to even happen. Okay? Remember in part two, we talk in a beingness words a lot. Like, who was I being to not go to the gym in that moment?
Lazy.
Yeah.
The bratty.
I was being lazy. I was being bratty. I was being irresponsible. You know, whatever it is for you. Like, what would you say if you were to look at it, like, how are you being in that moment in the car when you decided this is ridiculous, this is rude, this is inconsiderate? Like, this is where we say, start to determine your accountability in the matter. So this is where you want to say to yourself, okay, who was I being when I was sitting in the car at that moment? Like, what would you say you were being?
Judgmental.
Judgmental. Yeah. So you were being judgmental. Anything else? You think maybe like a little victim-y? Like, how could she do this to me? Like, you think like a little victim-y at all?
Yeah.
You know, so determine your accountability matter. So if you're like, wow, I'm being a victim right now. I'm being judgmental, right?
Would that be a victim? Like, say somebody's getting mad at you from whatever they story they said in their own head. One day earlier, it was a different girl. She started telling me I was Edith Bunker. Okay. I wanted to go to the Kentucky Derby thing, and she wanted to sit because of her back, so we were at a place, and I was like, this is Kentucky Derby Day, I haven't seen you in 2 years, and I said, we'll get together, but do we have to sit at a freaking restaurant? You know what I mean? Where no Kentucky Derby thing's going on. So I was like, can we go somewhere else or whatever? So we went to somewhere else, and that wasn't anything. So I was just like, oh, whatever, let me just watch this one TV while the Kentucky Derby's going on. You know, I'm not.
Yeah, it's a little big for me, right?
She started calling me Edith Bunker.
Sure.
And I said, that's insulting.
Yeah. And so that's your interpretation. Like, that's That's you interpreting, so bringing it back to part to number two, that's you and your interpretation of the event. It's not really the facts. She spoke words.
Okay.
Facts.
So in that
she
case,
spoke words, and then you interpreted her words into what you just said.
Well, she actually said, yeah.
Right, but you put the meaning to it. You put the meaning to it that it's rude, it's mean, it's disrespectful, it hurts. She just spoke words. She could have said green frog, blue frog,
okay.
You know, and you're putting the meaning to it. She could have said that to me, and I would have no meaning to it. Some people might be like, I don't even know what you're talking about, didn't land. You know?
That's very good.
So, like, you put the meaning to that.
And reacted.
And you created the energy and the charge in that. Edith Bunker analogy. Like, you're the one that put meaning to it. It's just like if somebody said, you're a blue frog. You know, it might not have as much of a charge or meaning because you're putting their interpretation to it. And down here, we're saying, how am I accountable for the result, you know, that I had of my broken agreement? So this is how we handle it. We say, okay, so determine your accountability in the matter. Okay, I was being judgmental. I was being a victim. And then when we do that, it brings us to number four, where it says, determine the commitment or the intention that must have been in place consciously or unconsciously that caused the broken agreement. Okay? So just notice your commitment or the intention that must have been in place. So here's the thing we say in gratitude training context and in the trainings. You're always committed to something. Only 100% of the time. Because you always have some kind of result, and it's based on your commitment. So when people say, oh, I'm just not committed to it, based on results, you were just committed to being in an argument with your friend instead of having a loving, free, fun friendship. Based on results, your intention was to eat cookies and watch TV. How do I know?
Because that's what I did.
Because that's what you did. So that's where we start to look at that in gratitude context when we say, what was more important than me being my word? And that's when it brings us back to those. Looking good, being right, being in control, forgetting one, being safe and comfortable, okay? So it brings us back to that. What was more important, right? This is going back to those survival contexts, okay? Based on the result, that's what you were committed to, and it's neutral. I don't care that you sat in bed and ate cookies and watched TV. You know, it's a neutral event, okay? Then number five is we regenerate your original commitment, meaning what do you see now as possible and what actions will you do and take and by when, okay? So in Masterful Living, we start to put what we call a promise in there, like we promise a certain time, like by when, okay? So bring back your original commitment. So what are you committed to with your friend?
Yeah, you lost me.
Okay.
Determine the commitment or intention that must have been in place. Okay, so subconsciously I was judging.
So you're going back to four here?
Yeah.
Okay.
And I was judgmental, and I was trying to start a fight.
Well, that's how you're being accountable.
Being.
I was judgmental, and I was victim.
In my mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, in that moment, you were being judgmental, and you were being, like, from a victim context, right? That's what was going on in your thoughts. How could she do this to me? And then, you know,
she just put me down.
Right.
And
so you're being a victim of, like, her words she's saying to you.
Yeah.
So that's what we're saying, you're being accountable. So down here we're saying,
right,
so down here we're saying, determine the commitment, and we say intention, because we say that intention and commitment are the same thing. Like putting your intention towards something, what you're committed to creating, okay, are the same thing, that must have been in place, consciously or unconsciously, that caused the broken agreement. So you're saying, what do I mean by that? I lost you.
What is my broken agreement then?
Okay.
To keep unhealthy relationships happy?
Well, when we started, do you remember what you said your broken agreement was?
Remember,
I asked you, when was the moment you decided that you broke your agreement to yourself?
But I
I didn't love myself enough. I stayed there and I loved, I tried to make somebody else happy.
Yeah, you said that the moment you stayed 30 minutes, you realized that you broke your word to yourself and the other things you had to do that evening.
Yeah.
So that's when you realize that you had the broken agreement. So that's what we're talking about here. So when you ask the question, that's exactly that caused you to stay in the car for 30 minutes. Like, you can actually just take broken agreement out of there and say, watch this. Determine the commitment or the intention that must have been in place that caused me to stay in the car for 30 minutes longer than I wanted to. You see that? How you just substitute that. So you're saying, this is where we have you look at, wow, so unconsciously I was committed to sitting in the car for 30 minutes, and unconsciously she's committed to eating cookies in bed because she sold out, you sold out to looking good, and she sold out to being right, you said, or comfortable, or both.
Probably that and being in control.
And being in control. Okay? So this is where you guys, like, this is like the juiciness, right? That we start to look at that and go, oh yeah, I ate cookies and I stayed in bed. Oh, I really pissed my friend off, you know, last night. I really pissed my friend off. Okay, when did that happen? Oh, that's totally when I sat in the car for 30 minutes. That's when it happened. Oh, it happened with me, like, the second I, like, ate that fourth cookie, you know, or whatever it is. So that's what we're saying, determine the commitment that had you consciously or unconsciously, and a lot of times it's unconsciously, you know, and that's why we step into this work, so you start to be conscious of the choices that you're making and that it's neutral. Like, you and your friend spoke words, but it all started because you broke your agreement to yourself. Like when you sat in that car an extra 30 minutes. So we say, what was more important than being my word, which is this. Right here. You see that? What was more important than you leaving that driveway on time and waiting for your friend was pleasing her. Was pleasing others. That's exactly what number four.
I wanted to go to that restaurant, so I just said, okay, fine. I wanted to go to a...
Yeah.
An event.
Yeah. So that's exactly, but what we're saying is you do this in the car. Like, this is a tool that you could have absolutely done in the car in the moment, which would then bring us to number five. In that moment when you say to yourself, yeah, I totally was more committed to being right in control, ate those cookies. Oh, okay. And then you take ownership of that and it becomes a neutral event. So then we can step into regenerating your original commitment, okay? Regenerating your original commitment. What do you now see as possible? So think about it. In that moment, how could you regenerate your commitment?
Like now or when I was...
When you were there. Like in that moment when you're like, I'm shoving these cookies, I'm watching this TV. Like in that moment, if you use this tool, how could you have regenerated your original commitment?
I could see possible loving myself as I finish the cookies and making a new commitment to go to the gym on Tuesday.
Okay. So what do you now see as possible? So the possibility you saw is recommitting to going to the gym at a different date and time.
Yeah.
That was your possibility. And then what actions will you take and by when? And you said Tuesday by
8 o'clock.
A.m.? By 8 p.m. So do you see how that's you regenerating your original commitment?
Yeah. I'm going to have to renegotiate that one because I have another commitment. But
yeah. I mean, you could have even taken it the next level and say, I'm going to eat two more cookies and then in a half hour I'm going to the gym. Mm-hmm. Like, you could have even regenerated, like, that quickly. Mm-hmm. You could have done that. Tuesday's cool, too. But, like, I'm saying that it can be such a powerful tool that in that moment, Terry, you could have easily just said to your, like, said, okay, so I'm going to, okay, so in that moment you're like, oh my God, you're getting all angry and you're getting all this experience and you're getting all upset. You could simply just go, okay, I'm clear on all of this. What's possible? Like, to just sit in your car and go, this is my friend. I love her unconditionally. Really ticking me off right now. I really want to go to this restaurant. What am I committed to creating with her right now? What do I want to generate? I have a new commitment from right now. I'm going to let my feelings go. Thank you, feelings. Pop. On the passenger seat. What am I committed to now? And in that moment, you could say, I'm committed to having whatever it is, a joyful, fun, free, connected night with my friend, and surrendering and choosing a new restaurant so that you could spend time with your friend, not being so attached to that restaurant. You know, it could simply be like, hey, let's order food in. You know, like whatever it is, like there could be a new possibility. You see that? Like there could be a new possibility. So what would you say in that moment you could see it could have been a new possibility?
Well, that's where, again, I'll get confused because what I wanted, and I had planned for 2 days to go to the racetrack to watch the Kentucky Derby. She didn't want to.
Yeah.
She,
well, what's possible in that moment?
So
I,
in
I,
that moment, we're
yeah.
sitting there at the restaurant. In that moment, what you're saying is that I could say, okay, you know, I'm just going to have a good time with my friend, the hell with the Kentucky, it is what it is already. That's where I'm pleasing others again.
Right.
So I don't want to do that. I'm going to stop doing that because then I'm going to walk away after the day and go, look, we didn't even see the Kentucky Derby. I never get to do anything for
yeah.
my dance.
And it's even a next step for you, right? So it's not like, oh, forget that. It's coming. What do you see now as possible? So it could be like, hey, you know what? I really want to get there. I'll meet you there, right? It could be like, hey, I'm going to head out because it's starting soon. I'll meet you there. And I guarantee you that
well,
that probably
what?
Stopped you.
I'm just going to be double. And then she says, well, you're a selfish bitch.
Right. But that's her interpretation of that. Whatever that is.
So that's a green frog. I say that
yeah.
in my mind.
You know, that's her interpretation. So you can say, you know what, I'm really excited to see this with you. Do you know how much longer you're going to be? Because it really matters for me to be there on time. And it could be, and you can do that in a way and say, so, you know what, if it's cool with you, I'm going to head out and I'll meet you there. You know? And here's the thing, she's either going to come or she's not going to come. And then
she's going to say, you know what, you flipping couldn't wait 15 minutes more for me?
Right, but the point is that you kept your agreement to yourself.
Right, and then she's going to be mad.
Well, that's like, but here's the thing. Yeah, that's like you kept your agreement
yeah.
to yourself, right? The whole point of this is that you broke your agreement to yourself.
Correct.
And then you're going to sit here and you're going to have all this energy on her, and then you're going to keep people pleasing, and you're going to keep having the same results.
Right.
You know, so here's the thing, like, you're either going to continue to do these, like handling broken agreements, like you call your friend and say, hey, you know what, I realize, you know, we're fighting, leave a voice message, whatever it is, write a text, you know, like, hey, like, look, I understand, like, we're not getting along right now. I just want you to know, you know, that, you know, what did you guys end up going?
Yeah.
Okay.
It became a disaster.
So why'd she get mad at you?
Well, it was good for 2 hours. And then the boyfriend showed up, and then she wanted to stay longer with him. I wanted to go.
Got it. So that's what you need to see her. Be like, hey, I want to, you know, I just want to touch base with you, you know, and I want you to know I got a little irritated at the end of the night when you guys wanted to stay later, and, you know, I realized that I was mad at myself. I'm not mad at you, that I'm mad at myself because, you know, I had a certain time that I wanted to get home, and I didn't do that. You know, I didn't do that, and so the real fact of the matter is that I was mad at myself, that I didn't keep my word to myself and leave when I wanted to leave. It had nothing to do with you or your boyfriend. And I just wanted you to know that. You know, I wanted you to know that because our friendship means a lot to me. You know, and the little bickering that we had, I don't even want to pay that price of losing you as a friend because you mean too much to me. And, you know, I just want you to know what I'm committed to right now is having, like, an amazing friendship with you. And, you know, in a loving friendship and a fun friendship. And, you know, I just want you to know that I'm sorry. I'm sorry if I hurt your feelings at all or if any way you felt offended. And I just want you to know that I didn't mean to create that, you know, in you. And I want you to know that I see us having an amazing friendship for years to come. I see you us having an amazing friendship for years to come. And I would love to set up another time to get together. And I'd love to hear back from you as soon as possible because I'd love to do something with you on Saturday. It's like owning it. How many times are, like, in the world even, is war being created because somebody can't say sorry? You know, like, I mean, think about, like, all the broken families because somebody just can't apologize. Like, the domestic abuse that gets, like, in houses, like, the verbal abuse, all of that because people just walk around with, like, stuff that you're saying, friendships, and then what happens? People feel lonely. And then people feel lonely, and then they get depressed. And what happens in the world is what? Like, suicide. Right? Suicide happens in the world because people think that they're lonely and that they don't have anyone, when we can simply just be this and do this. And, you know, it to come from accountability and to be that with your friend. And to not sit there and go, but she did this, or she did this, or she, like, she did that. But for you to come from, just as I said, in your own way, and what's real for you. But for you to just say that, and then you have to be willing to be okay with her response.
Yeah, well, she doesn't want to be.
Yeah, and you got to be willing,
you know,
to be okay with that.
And, I'm, don't want
and
to
it doesn't mean in another week you can't do it again. That's the beauty of this work. Doesn't mean in another week you can't sit there and go, hey, I miss you, thinking about you. And then there's going to come a point where you're just not going to do that anymore. And you're going to be okay with it. Masterful Living is going to help you with that. Support you with that. Mm-hmm. Really is. Okay? So, that's handling broken
is that
agreements.
MLK? You keep Masterful Living.
Masterful Living is part
ML3.
Three. That's what we were talking to.
Three. So, Masterful
right.
Living is ML, which is part three.
Okay.
And this is what this is. I'm talking to you from a place of mastery here. So be gentle on yourself sitting here, because Emily's a graduate, and I can see in her face she's going with some stuff. You know, so that be kind to yourself as you're learning and as you're stepping in and as you're growing. These are tools. We don't expect you to walk out of here tonight and be a professional at it. You know, these are tools, and you keep coming to these Distinction Mondays, keep taking the other workshops, enroll in Masterful Living, you know, and I promise you, for 90 plus days, you're going to do this every single day of your life, and it's just going to become an automatic, like, reaction to you instead of what you've been doing now. Okay? Does that make sense? Okay, awesome. How are we on time? Do we need a break now, or do I have some more time?
You got some more time.
Okay. So really quick, before we take a break, I'm going to actually have you guys do a quick dyad together. Do you remember what that is from part one?
Can I take a picture of that?
Yeah, I'm cool with that.
Okay. That's all I'm...
Yeah.
If you're okay with it.
Yeah.
Because your notes seem really clear.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. So dyad. You guys remember what that is? You're going to pull your chairs in with each other. You don't need your notebook during this.
Okay.
Put it on the chair. You're
going to
face your chair.
Tell I'm trying.
I do. I love it. I don't think you're trying. I think you're having it happen.
Yeah.
You want to turn your chair? Like, pick it up and turn and face your chair. Yep. There you go. You're going to face each other. And what we're going to do, we're going to choose a partner A and a partner B. So partner A, tap partner B on the knee. Don't all jump at once. Okay. And what we're going to do is we're going to use this. We're going to have a practice in it right now. So you guys are going to practice with each other. And what we're going to do is we're going to use examples that matter to you, okay? So what that means is you're going to do a simple broken agreement, a simple one, okay? What do you think I mean by simple?
Like, I didn't go to the gym.
Yep, that'd be a simple one. I didn't go to the gym. I didn't do my homework. I called out sick to work, whatever it is.
For work, yeah.
I went 80 on the highway instead of, you know, 65, whatever it is. A simple broken agreement, okay? And we're going to do this process right here. That's why it's here for you guys. I'll even go like this. Okay? So that's why it's here, because they're all right here. Okay? So you're each going to have 2 minutes to talk about. Right now, we're going to do a simple broken agreement. So you're going to do this whole process, each of you, in 2 minutes. So like a minute apiece. Okay? So get out of your head and just do this and support each other. Okay? So you guys are just going to talk to each other. I'm going to talk for a minute. So you're going to start off by saying, You know, you might look at Emily and go, Emily, I acknowledge my broken agreement for not going to the gym. You know, what I made up, you know, what I made up about myself was that I was lazy, uncommitted, okay, all of that stuff, okay? Determine your accountability in that, okay? You would sit there and say, how am I accountable in this matter? Okay, well, I really wasn't committed to going to the gym. I just said that to look good, or, you know, whatever that is for you. And then notice your intention, okay? What was more important than being my word? That goes back to the survival context, looking good, being right, being in control, okay? And then you're going to recommit. What I see now possible is for me to go to the gym 3 days a week, whatever it is, you know, and I'm going to start that on Tuesday at 5 p.m., okay? And you'll have so a minute each to do this, okay? So I'll tell you in a minute so then you guys can switch, okay? So ready, begin.
Said that I would call my grandmother. I didn't. The interpretation that I made up is that I was busy, I'm a crappy granddaughter, I haven't talked to her in weeks, I'm avoiding it. And the way that I was being that would have me not call her is I was being afraid. I was being a coward. Being in denial, because she's old and it's hard to call that. I was definitely committed to being safe and being comfortable. And being right that she wouldn't remember if someone had to call her anyway. So it was more important for me to be right. So what I now see possible is being my word, and the committed action that I will take is calling her tomorrow by 5 p.m. and scheduling a brunch with her.
All right. Awesome. And switch.
Your turn.
Okay. Broken agreement is I didn't do my resume or apply for a job again for weeks. So just change that. That I'm afraid I'm not good enough. Like, no, the facts are I didn't sit down, I didn't type it up, I didn't make an action plan, you know, I didn't do the resume. Accountability is,
well, what would your interpretation be in that situation about yourself?
The facts are that I didn't do it, but the interpretation is that I'm not good enough, I got anxiety, so I'm nervous. I'm never going to get a job that I want. I don't want to apply for a job that I don't want. My accountability is that I could have just sat down and put in one, could have done the resume, and I could have put in at least.
So the accountability is like the ways of being that would have you break your agreement.
I'm not good enough.
So that would be the interpretation. Maybe the accountability could be like, I was being this way, and that's why it didn't happen. Like for me in the gym, I was being lazy, I was being bratty.
Like ways of being here, right? So I was, yeah.
Number three?
Yeah, so I was being, like, what were you being that didn't have you submit your resume?
Lazy.
Hello, Emily.
Lazy and self-sabotage, not good enough, reject, rejecting myself before I even put it in. determine the commitment. No. Yeah, to determine the commitment.
Determine the commitment and intention. It must have been a place that caused you to not turn in your resume, because that was a broken agreement. And then what was more important than turning in my resume?
So, like, what had you
being
not...
Being safe, comfort zone, not get rejected.
Okay, and the last one?
Original commitment. The action I'll take is to... get it done and put in my resume to at least 5 by Friday.
Nice. Okay. Awesome. You see that? So did you feel a little empowered at the end when you're like, I'm going to submit that resume by Friday at 5 p.m.? So that's what this does. So imagine if you did this only all the time with everything in your life. It's a powerful tool that we use in transformation, and we use it in every single level of the training, literally. And you will use it every day, and then when you stop, you will teach others on how to use this as well, okay? So that's how to handle a broken agreement. It was a lot, okay? It's a lot, and what we're gonna do now is we're gonna take a 10-minute break, and then we're gonna come back, and we're gonna go into an exercise that Jay's gonna lead us. We're gonna play some music, he's gonna talk in the mic, and he's gonna bring you back into a process that actually is going to have stuff that you just spoke into, like all those conversations of I'm not good enough, I don't have what it takes, I'm rejectable, I'm lonely, you know, I'm lazy, I'm discardable, like whatever they are, like it's going to be a process that's going to heal you, and you'll remember it probably from your part one when you come back. So you are bathrooms back there if you need to go.